I would like to talk about God because you believe in him. And in particular, I want to talk about Aquinas' five ways.
Great.
What are they? Rattle them off.
Perfect. There are five of them. They're enumerated in Prima Pars Question 2, Article 3. Thank you.
That's right. And it's easy to remember. 1, 2, 3 for those at home.
1, 2, 3. Exactly. Yeah, that's a helpful mnemonic. So the first one is from motion. The second one is from efficient causality. The third is from contingency. The fourth is from gradation. Oh, yeah.
Yeah,
what's
well
up,
done.
Dude? And then the fifth is from teleology, or final causality.
Finality.
Oh, my gosh. I was hoping for a cheers.
Slasher. Nice. Well done. Now, many people, because we've just been through this new atheism phase, which really seems to be dying out
now.
And the Jordan Peterson thing seems to be filling its void.
Right.
That's so interesting to me.
I think that
no one's interested in listening to Dawkins anymore. Harris seems like a really interesting guy.
Yeah.
He still has some popularity. But Peterson, with his respect of religion, even if he hasn't affirmed necessarily that he believes in God, though he says he lives like he does, that seems to have taken its place, which I think is an interesting phenomenon of its own. But anyway.
I think the new atheism kind of overplayed its hand. I think they leaned too heavily into, like, the vitriol. They became so convinced of their arguments that they gave them with too much gusto, and I think it actually turned off their audience.
There wasn't enough nuance.
Well, I think, like, in a certain sense, like, I think a lot of millennials are conflict-averse, right? So, like, a lot of millennials may not necessarily have any affinity for religion. You know, a lot of them identify as nuns. But they don't like intolerance or something that smacks of violence because that's perceived as like a cultural evil. And the new atheism, I think, overplayed its hand in, like, it just made such a caricature of religion, or it, like, lampooned theology in such a way that they kind of, it just begs credulity. And it's also angry. So it's very hard to follow somebody who's, like, you know, like, philosophically unfair and also, like, very, very mean.
Well, it definitely, I think, appealed to teenage men and young adult men, right?
I think for a time.
There's a sense in which it appears masculine at first because it's very abrasive. Like, Christopher Hitchens was a wordsmith. He was brilliant. He was charming.
No, he's a good writer.
And he also seemed to, like, state his opinion, and I'm not going to worry about your feelings. I'm just going to speak the facts. I think there's something kind of that appeals to the masculine in that.
Yeah. What did I read? I read a book recently called Seven Types of Atheism by a guy named John Gray. And he kind of does, he's reacting against the new atheism, which he thinks is basically it's religious in the sense that it's indebted to certain religious beliefs. So it espouses this notion about, like, monotheism, or it at least grants the terms of religion. It lets religion sets the terms of debate. Whereas he, like, advocates in the book for other more tolerant types of atheism.
Is he an atheist?
I think so. Yeah. He said he's most inclined towards the atheism of, like, a George Santa Anna or, like, a Joseph Conrad, something like along those lines, where it's like there's a kind of, like, nobility of the human spirit before the inky blackness of the void of meaning.
Interesting.
You know, it's like man's nobility is basically to stand before the absurd and
not
to press
blink.
On.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Which, you know, like, you can see evidence of that in, like, Camus and The Plague or The Stranger and stuff. But I mean, I think that, like, what millennials want now is authenticity, sincerity, a kind of coherent form of life. And they see the hatred or violence or, you know, the caricatured nature of some new atheist arguments, and they find that unappealing. But I think these other types of atheism, I think, are going to have better purchase. A lot of them are philosophical, so they're always going to be the particular province of few. But, yeah, those are my thoughts.
There are obviously some scary smart atheists. I know you're not saying this, but they're obviously not just the kind of philosophically inept types. Like,
no.
Dawkins is evidently philosophically inept. When you look at his summary of the five ways, he literally misunderstands every one of them in a pretty obvious, glaring way. So do you think that there's one particular way of Aquinas's that you find the most convincing, or do you think they make a good cumulative case that when you put them all together, they're the most convincing?
Both. I know that's not an answer.
No, that's all right. Which it is. It was a false dilemma, and you split the horns. Which is the most compelling?
For me, it's the third way.
Yeah, a lot of people say that.
Yeah, I don't know why. Just, like, The way I think about it is that...
I want you to explain it to us as well. Because those at home have no idea what this is. So convince me that God exists the third way.
With pleasure. I'm going to do a little preluding.
Go for it.
And then interluding. And then postluding. There's going to be a lot of looting.
All right. Cool. Loot away.
So, yeah, cheers. So with the five ways, first thing with which you need to approach is like kind of like the right disposition. So the five ways are not going to like blow you out of your seat. They're not going to make your socks go up and down. They're not going to like burn off one eyebrow, you know, whatever. What they are going to do, though, if you continue to return to them, is exercise a kind of like conceptual therapy. So here's the thing. I said that what we're accustomed to, or the lines along which we're accustomed to think, are these like materialist, reductionist, naturalist lines. From a young age, you know, you see the periodic table of elements and somebody just tells you, these are the building blocks of all material things. And you're like, okay. And then you think atomistically, like everyone basically thinks atomistically. Instead of saying, hey, these are like energy / electrical things that go to constitute what is most basic in your understanding, like your cat, for instance. So instead of starting with like substances, we start with building blocks. So we're always reducing. We're always thinking materialistically. We're always thinking in this kind of new paradigm of science. When you read the five ways, though, it's kind of introducing you into a new or better or older way of thinking, which is to say like a metaphysical understanding of reality. So instead of approaching reality from like, what's at the bottom of it? Or like, how do I clear away things that are distracting me? You're asking the question of what is and why. So how did this thing come to be? How does it sustain its existence? And how do we account for that philosophically? So there's this like kind of conceptual therapy that has to go on. One of my confreres, Father Raymond Snyder, he likens this to, apparently there's a Monty Python sketch about the most hilarious joke ever.
This is where you never see what it is. They're just showing each other and bursting out laughing.
And then dying, yeah.
Yeah.
Well, like the guy who writes it finds it so hilarious and then dies. And his wife comes in the room, she reads it, and then she dies. And then there's like a bunch of police investigators. They all die. They figure it out. Eventually, they like have it translated into German and then like project it one word at a time across the lines and like kill all the soldiers. But people like look at the proofs, or they hear that there are proofs for the existence of God, and they expect them to be like the funniest joke in the world. Like it's going to absolutely devastate them.
Yeah. Like, and they cannot not question.
Yeah, so but people will look at them and they'll say, well, that is expressed in a philosophical paradigm that I've never encountered before. Fascinating, but whatever. And then they'll be like, and I didn't believe in God before I encountered it, and I still don't believe in God. So what does that mean? Does that mean that the proofs for the existence of God don't work? Not necessarily.
If they don't compel us?
Yeah, no, because they're not like, it's not like their efficacy is proved by suasion, you know? It's not like, in order for me to carry my point, I need to convince everyone in the room of it. Now, true things are just true because they correspond to reality, okay? So it's either true or it's not. As to whether or not we can access that, different thing. So when you approach the five ways, you're doing conceptual therapy. You're inhabiting a metaphysical world. You're looking at the world the way that St. Thomas looked at the world. In a certain sense, you're seeing it under the aspect of being. And reality becomes transparent to your gaze, and you see it as so many things issuing from an unmoved mover, or a first cause, or the necessary being, or what is utmostly good and beautiful, or what is the final cause of all. So, yeah, with all of the different arguments, basically, you start with some observation of what is in reality. Mm-hmm. So, like, in the first way, St. Thomas says, this is the most evident way. This is the argument from motion. And he says that there are things, and they are moving. And he says, cheers, let's go from there. which is significant, because in modern philosophy, you can't even get people to acknowledge that. René Descartes is like, okay, I kind of distrust my sense, or like my sense knowledge, mm-hmm. as a result of which I need to build everything up by a new method. Mm. And in that new method, I need to prove everything from kind of pure postulates of reason. So that's just like, whatever.
Can we just say how fun that would have been to be with Descartes in his dressing gown?
Oh, yeah, and his nightcap.
Oh, my gosh, just smoking a doobie. And be like, can't we doubt?
Those are the best parts of the Method on Discourse. Or
they
whatever.
Are
yeah.
absolutely the best.
When he describes his raiment. his pale raiment's hem.
Oh, my gosh.
So we're looking at at reality, and we are admitting it as such. So we're not doubting our sense experience, because St. Thomas wouldn't even like... He would think that was insane. He just says motion is evident to the senses.
Mm. And by motion, he doesn't just mean locomotion.
No.
Say.
Right. So there's locomotion, and then there's change or alteration. So like somebody goes from being, or something goes from being like white to black. And then there's what he calls, you know, growth or diminution. Something goes from being big to small, small to big, or this shaped to that shaped. Something gains weight, kind of like loses its
an apple
physical
rots,
fitness or? Exactly. Yeah, and then like the final sense of change is substantial change, but he says that's not like motion in the strict sense, so we'll leave that aside. So basically we're talking about like changing in place, changing in quality, and then changing in size. And so he just says like, okay, things are changing. How do we account for that? And then this is the big thing that he introduces in all of the five ways, is the distinction between act and potency. And at first you're like, duh, weird words. But they need not be weird or intimidating. Because potency, as you might expect from, you know, how we use it in English, is what a thing can be, right? So like act is what a thing is. It's the current traits or the current qualities or whatever that it's giving expression to as we encounter it.
So you're actually sitting.
I'm actually sitting.
You're potentially standing.
I'm actually wearing a wristwatch. I'm actually, a Caucasian male. Mm-hmm. I am actually, et cetera. You know, like, how tall am I? 6'4", and I weigh like however many pounds I weighed. Mm-hmm. I don't actually remember. different sense of actually. right. But I am potentially a number of things. So I am potentially standing. I am potentially not wearing a wristwatch. I am potentially shorter,
You're not potentially Native American.
Here's the thing,
like
though.
Elizabeth Warren.
Right. No. So, actually, I am, though. I'm 1/16th Native American.
Are you?
My great-great-grandmother,
Nancy
Kidd.
Is that more than Elizabeth Warren?
I don't know. I don't adjudicate these decisions.
No,
exactly. I don't follow. But I've never done the swab thing, so I, like a lot of people, am probably claiming more.
So you're actually part Native American.
Yeah.
All right, we're getting off.
I'm not potentially Chinese.
Right.
Okay, let's settle the terms. Settle the terms.
Done.
So what you are actually is the qualities that you're currently giving expression to. What you are potentially are those things you could give expression to, but you're not presently, right? And those terms are set by the kind of thing that you are.
Right.
Right, so like you said, I'm potentially standing, but I am not potentially flying, mm-hmm. right, by my own steam mm-hmm. because of the thing that I am. So he says, whenever you have a change, you're moving something from potency to act. So whether it's a change in place, it's potentially over there, and then it's actually over there. Or if it's a change in quality, it's potentially red, and then it's actually red. Or if it's a change in size, it's potentially 5'3", and then it's actually 5'3". And then he says, in order to get from being potentially so to actually so, you need something to bring it there.
Actualize it.
Something to actualize it. Something to make it to be such.
Okay.
And then he says that thing has to already be actually so. Now, it doesn't actually have to be like, for instance,
in this location,
standing right. or in this location or 5'2", but it has to have the power to bring that about, either like virtually or, we can go into that, but it's not actually worth the long description. Ed Fazer has a great description of it. It is in Aquinas' book.
He's very good.
Cheers, Ed Fazer. Mm-hmm. But then he says, let's go back to that thing that has it actually. What made it to be such? Mm-hmm. And then you see where this is going. Long series of causes. But he says, you can't go all the way back to some first thing.
Or all the way up.
Or all the way up infinitely. Because then nothing would actually cause the next thing to be in motion if there weren't some first thing causing all of this to obtain. Now I've gone ahead and just described the entire first way. Whoops.
Now what happens at this point is almost everybody thinks you're talking about linear causality. And they think this is essentially like the Kalam argument that has to do with beginnings.
Right.
Like you flick the first, there had to be someone to flick the first domino.
Yeah.
But that isn't what he means.
That's not what he means. What he's talking about is, existential dependence. Yeah. What we're talking about is what causes these things to be.
Now.
And the third way gets to this like best, I think, and most illustratively. But the idea is basically like what we're talking about is not just like A pushes B, B pushes C, C pushes D ad infinitum. What we are talking about is sometimes called an essentially subordinated series of causes. Mm-hmm. That is to say that like you have a lamp, all right, and the lamp is suspended by a link, and that link by another link, and that link by another link, etc. So what causes the lamp to hang? Link number one. What causes link number one to hang? Link number two. And then you go back and eventually you get to the ceiling. And then eventually, what causes the ceiling to stand? The walls. What causes the walls to stand? The foundation. What causes the foundation to stand? And you can just keep going. But eventually, you get to a certain thing beyond which you cannot progress. Okay? You have to get to the point of what causes these things to be and to be causes. And that's ultimately where all of these arguments end up, or how they all eventuate. Because, all right, now I'm going to talk about the third way.
Yeah.
If you want.
Just do it.
All right, cool.
And pretend we're on an airplane.
Yes.
And you've got a limited amount of time.
I'm going to give you the Heideggerian summary. Why is there something rather than nothing?
You want me to answer that?
You could.
I don't know.
Nice. Well, St. Thomas seems to think that, like, we have to account for that. Now, people differ as to whether or not that's a good representation of the third way, but I think it's pretty good for elevator speech.
Yeah.
Why is there something?
Who said that this is the greatest philosophical question that can ever be asked? I forgot, but...
I don't know. Herbert McCabe, who was a Dominican who lived in England for a while. Well, he's since passed, but he liked to come back to this question with regards to the third way. He just thought that it was just like... I was just going to say, it's a good introduction to metaphysical thinking.
It really is.
Because most people don't think in those terms.
In fact, people have just heard you say that right now on YouTube and don't even understand why you would even ask that. They haven't understood the gravity of it. And maybe we never could understand it to the full gravity of it. But yeah, why is that an important question?
Well, it's because...
There could be nothing, presumably. Or they couldn't if God exists.
Yeah. No, like, because when you look at contingent things, which is everything that we experience except for God.
Right.
When you look at all of them, you have to know, or you have to see, perceive at some level, that it could have been otherwise.
This could have been red.
Or it could have been not. Right?
Yeah.
And that doesn't have to, like, take into account, like, well, we're not talking, like, in terms of moral tragedy, like, you could have been hit by a bus on your way here. It's like, okay, that's true enough, but, like, you could have just not been. And that's true of everything.
Mm.
So then why is there something?
If everything is a great, may not have been. Yeah.
Exactly. If everything is might not have been.
Why is it?
Why is it? And you eventually have to get back to a has to have been or simply is.
Oh, beautiful. Say it again. Let's do it again. Let's circle the wagons again here.
Mm, okay. So when you look at everything created,
yeah,
you have to recognize that it might not have been.
This stuff.
Mm, exactly.
Doesn't have to be.
That doesn't have to be. I could literally pick that up and smash that right now, except that I'd have to clean it up, and my mother would be disappointed in my barbarity, or I guess barbarism.
Yeah. You'd know more than me.
No, I don't know. Okay, so everything might not have been, and we see that. We can perceive that.
Yeah.
And
this TV, I don't mean to keep doing this at a snail's pace, especially because I asked you to prove it so succinctly, but I mean, this TV didn't have to exist. This cup didn't have to exist. My parents could have never have met. This book didn't have to exist.
Yeah.
The stars in the sky as we see them didn't have to exist.
No. Yeah, because nothing has a sufficient explanation for its own being. Nothing like, all of these things, when we see them, they don't say, like, I am this, and it is necessary that I be this and that I exist. Because, like, you know, we have some notions as to things that have existed and no longer exist or things that never exist. Like, we know that there were dodo birds, right? I associate them with Australia, but maybe that's a false association.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think so.
Cheers. We also know that, like, unicorns capture the imaginations of 7-year-old girls the world over.
Yeah.
But that they have never been, unless you count narwhals.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or unless they're unicorns on another planet. I guess that's possible, right?
Alternate reality unicorns? Yeah. Unicorn aliens. Or robot unicorns. Okay, so that these things don't exist, right? But when we look at these things, they do. And there's no intrinsic reason as to why that's the case. Like, this is like a unicorn in the sense that it's something conceivable.
Yeah.
A Chemex pot, I think
it's
called,
right? Yeah, if this never existed, you could have conceived it. And someone did conceive it and then made
it. Before they made it, exactly, yeah. But it need not have. So when you look at this world populated by might not have beens, you have to account for the fact that they are, because they themselves do not supply the answer. They are incompetent to supply the answer. And when you follow it back, you get to a has to have been, or simply is. And the sense is that because God, and you get this kind of like down the line in the first part of the Summa, God exhausts all that there is of being, right? God is. And that's to say, like, yeah, so like when we talk about God being eternal, right? That's not just to say that, like, God has infinite duration, like thinking about him in terms of time. When Boethius describes eternity, he says that it is the whole and simultaneous possession of endless life. Mm. The whole and simultaneous possession of endless life. So God holds all being in his embrace of himself. He exhausts everything that can truly be said of being. And so all being is a participation in his being, without getting like into like pantheism, blah, 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 you get it. So when we look at all of these things, we recognize that they lack, they don't have being in that way. They only have it as a kind of product of happenstance. Well, not to say that everything is a chance encounter, but that they only share in or participate being, but they lack it in its entirety. So you have to get back to something,
that
someone.
Has a nature.
Yeah, that just is. whose very essence is to be.
And so Dawkins here says, well, even if I grant that, that's a far, far cry from saying that this being is someone that answers my prayers, cares about the ways in which I have sex and with whom. And so you haven't even begun to make your case, which of course is rubbish because you have begun to make your case. And the Summa, of course, is more than two pages. I wish that Dawkins had have turned the page. You may have seen how Aquinas began to explain the attributes of God.
If you can
make the jump from atheism to theism, the jump from theism to Christian theism is a heck of a lot smaller, shorter, right?
Yeah, I think so.
So like a lot of your work's done.
Yeah.
Do you ever have doubts about God's existence?
No. But I don't know that I permit myself like extended periods of time of like nihilistic doubt.
Do you ever wonder that God doesn't exist and you've just, you know, you could be partying and having sex and making money and now
that's
you're
right.
Just
if God didn't exist, I would like worship the sun and just like stay unhygienically, you know, like bearded on top of mountains in like the Western United States. But he does, as a result of which I'm here.
I don't mean to caricature atheism as if to say if you're an atheist, you'll be an immoral person. That's not what I'm saying.
Sure.
But I mean, it's a fair question, and I imagine some priests think of it like, gosh. And even married people could think of it. Like, maybe God doesn't exist, and I'm just sort of wasting my life when I'd rather just be kind of hooking up with this woman instead. And, gee, I mean, if God doesn't exist, maybe monogamy's not natural after all, and that's why I'm, you know, you can see how people begin to spiral. But
yeah, Dostoevsky said something like, well, I think
so
it's in Bosque, like, if God doesn't exist, then all things are
permissible. Yeah, yeah, Ivan, I think, referenced something like that. And it's true, isn't it? I think it is true. If God doesn't exist, then all things are permissible in the realm of morality.
Yeah,
well, I think that they wouldn't be.
Well, I think that, like, so the vision that St. Thomas paints, well, the vision that, you know, like, Christ reveals, is that human flourishing, integral human flourishing... Is connected with our nature.
Sure.
So, like, we have a nature on which grace builds, mm-hmm. and it doesn't, like, scrap nature, right? Actually, there's a sweet translation of the Summa by these friars from the English province, sometimes referred to as the Gilby Summa, and it says this, quote, sorry, grace... does not consign nature to the rubbish heap.
Does it say that?
Oh, yeah.
I love
awesome.
The English.
Oh, my gosh. Super
to the
charming.
Rubbish bin.
Exactly. Yeah, so we have the kind of nature that is perfected by these kind of things, and it's not like grace radically changes what we are.
It
actually heals, it purifies, it elevates, it emboldens, and it brings us to our term where we ordinarily would not have been able to get there. So in a certain sense, I don't think it is true that if God doesn't exist, all things are permissible, because we are still the type of beings that we are, right?
Yeah, but we can, we are, but we, when I say permissible, I suppose we mean like morally acceptable.
Yeah.
Like I can still, we all choose to do things that we perceive to be good that end up being harmful. But when we do them, we say they're immoral and you ought not to have done that. But if God doesn't exist, can't I engage in behaviors that are self-destructive?
Certainly, you can. I mean, in the sense of like you're free to, when we speak of freedom as like license and a variety of options.
Yeah,
right.
Because then the best people can do is just say, yeah, it's not good for you. I'm like, I don't give a crap what's good for me. Well, it's not good for society. I don't care. Well, they'll hate you. Well, I hate them.
Yeah.
It's like,
well, this is like what utilitarians struggled with. And this is like what Kant is reacting against. He's like, wow, that's just like... selfishness. It's naturalistic selfishness, like bleh. And then he wanted a system of rules that would bind in such a way as to perfect the human creature. And he felt like he needed God as an enforcer or a lawgiver. In a certain sense, is like the buck stops here with respect to reward or vindication. So I don't like, okay, when we say that like if God doesn't exist, all things are permissible. On the one hand, that's true. Because if your life is not goal-oriented, then you can wend your way wherever you darn well please.
Choose your own goal.
So like I leave my driveway and I have no place in mind. I can make all turns.
That's
and
right.
In a certain sense, like for me, it's just about the driving.
So but the journey, not the destination. It's what we hear all the time.
Yeah. Tomfoolery and guffaw. But if I want to actually get somewhere and I recognize the fact that my happiness is bound up in a destination, then I am like constrained in a certain sense as to which turns I can take. Because if I turn right and I take the Boltwash Parkway, while it will be charming to see that little brick wall in the middle of the highway, I know that there are going to be like innumerable nonsensical slowdowns, and that's going to like wither my desire for life.
Mm-hmm.
But that's how I get to Philadelphia, you know, like that's how I get where I'm going. So I'm able to take that in stride. But if I'm, you know, if I'm not going to Philadelphia, if I'm just driving, I'm going to avoid the Boltwash Parkway like the plague.
Mm.
I'm just going to find open streets for cruising so I can listen to podcasts, you know, because I'm a nerd.
Mm.
So yeah. So yes.
Yeah.
Full thought.
Yo, thanks for watching. You can watch the entire episode on YouTube if you want. You can listen to it at The Matt Frad Show by subscribing on iTunes or wherever you listen to your podcasts. And feel free to support me, patreon.com/MattFrad.